should I stay or should I go now? If I go, there will be trouble, and if I stay, it will be double. So come on and let me know, should I stay or should I go? Famous lyrics of a song popular in the 80s by The Clash. Jehovah's Witnesses have a similar choice and have a similar trouble in deciding what to do. If they go, there will be trouble. If they stay in New York, it will be double. Being free from the cult-like organization means in many cases losing your family and friends. Or otherwise, if you stay, you get to keep your friends and family, but you lose your freedom. Catch 22. Whatever you do, whatever choice you make, you're doomed. Of course, making such a life-changing decision is not easy, especially for those who were subjected to mind control, emotional, spiritual blackmail, and religious lies for years. And we may already by this time now be a spiritual, emotional wreck. That's a situation that reminds me of the one of the Apostle Peter, who was in a similar emotional agony after he betrayed Jesus. Knowing well what Peter would do, Jesus said this to Peter. And these words are very encouraging. This is the scripture from Luke 22, 31 and 32. Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded to sift all of you like wheat. But I have prayed that your own faith may not fail. And once you have turned back, you must strengthen your brothers. So very much like Peter, we may also find ourselves in an agonizing pain. And that pain could very much hurt our faith. And that's why Jesus prayed that Peter's faith would not become weak. Our faith may well become weak, or may well have become weak due to all the years of mistreatment. However, Jesus was sure about one other thing. We read that there was going to be a turning back. When you turn back, you will strengthen your brothers. That turning back period might take some time. It may require grieving. It may require healing. So how much time does that grieving and healing or turning back take? It's all between us and God. Nobody can tell for yourself or anybody else how long would that period last. But Peter himself later was certain of the following. That's in another encouraging verse. It's from 2 Peter 3:9. It's the same Peter who had the emotional turmoil and agonizing pain. The Lord does not delay his promise, as some regard delay, but he's patient with you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Fortunately, God will be and is patient with us. So we should always take our time in healing, in recovering from all the stress we went through. So nobody can impose that on you. You should do this or you should do that. Staying or leaving, should I stay or should I go? Does it matter whether we decide to stay or to leave? If it is between us and God, is it then a matter of conscience? And if it is a matter of conscience, is it all the same what we decide? As most of us are from a background of Jehovah's Witnesses, sometimes matters of conscience seem unimportant to us. If something's not a disfellowshipping offense, hence it is okay to do it. But this is not the way Bible talks about conscience. So if leaving or staying is a matter of conscience, it's nevertheless an important decision. And it affects our relationship with God very much. Why can we tell that? Well, there was an instance in the first century where the matter of conscience was raised by the Apostle Paul. And the context was about eating food sacrificed to idols, but in a broader sense, we can apply it to this situation. So Romans 14, 22 and 23 say, keep the faith that you have to yourself in the presence of God. Blessed is the one who does not condemn himself for what he proves. But whoever has doubts is condemned if he eats, because this is not from faith. For whatever is not from faith is sin. So in order to make the right decision, even if it concerns our conscience, we need to have faith. And without faith, we could make a bad decision. So when deciding what to do, some of us try to come to a reasonable conclusion. We may have reasoned, why would I let the organization of Jehovah's Witnesses control my life, my friends and family? If they want me out, why let them succeed in that? If there's not any organized group of true Christians, we might as well stay where we are, because it doesn't really matter where we are. There are good and bad people everywhere. We don't want to be judgmental, do we? Or dogmatic or watchtower-minded. Everybody will be saved anyway. God is love and loves his children. What parent will reject his children? So these may have been our thoughts and our ideas that helped us to reach a conclusion or to make a decision. But if we want to be Christians, what is the real question? What does the Bible say? What would Paul say? What would Jesus say? If Paul were alive today, which counsel would he give us? Would he say the following? As long as you believe in Jesus and read the Bible and try to be a good person, it's okay. There were similar situations back then, and Paul was far from, well, tolerant of various approaches. We know that he was much more serious than that. I'm amazed that you are so quickly turning away from the one who called you with Christ's undeserved kindness to another sort of good news. Not that there is another good news, but there are certain ones who are causing you trouble and wanting to distort the good news about Christ. However, even if we or an angel out of heaven were to declare to you as good news something beyond the good news we declare to you, let him be accursed. As we have said before, and now I say again, whoever is declaring to you as good news something beyond what you accepted, let him be accursed. We may accuse Paul of being judgmental, of being dogmatic, of being narrow-minded, but this is inspired words by one of Jesus' apostles. If it applied to Christians in the first century, why shouldn't it apply to us today? However, the inspired word clearly says that in later times, some will fall away from the faith, paying attention to misleading inspired statements and teachings of demons by means of the hypocrisy of men who speak lies, whose conscience is seared as with a branding iron. Not the same which teachings we listen to, because some teachings may well be teachings of demons. Paul was very strict about what we should do with our faith and whom we listen to. And finally, let's listen to what Jesus had to say about that. Enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the road that leads to destruction, and those who enter through it are many. How narrow the gate and constricted the road that leads to life, and those who find it are few. Notice the words destruction on one side and road that leads to life. So we have a choice. There are not roads in between, just actually two roads. And also Jesus warns his disciples with following words. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but underneath are ravenous wolves. By their fruits you will know them. Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Just so, every good tree bears good fruit, and a rotten tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a rotten tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. So by their fruits, you will know them. So is it true that everybody who speaks about Jesus is on the right way, on the right path, on the right side? Well, according to Jesus, that's not true. We should beware of false prophets. It apparently does matter whether we should stay or we should go.